Welcome to the Big Biz Show, featuring insight, analysis, and a lot of stuff that's none of your business.
Hold on. This is the Big Biz Show. I think it is their business.
Making the markets work for you. Here's the man with the plan, Sully.
Well, look at us on a Wednesday. It's Hump Day! Mike! Was that ever something that you adopted, Hump Day? I guess he was a sports guy. Mike did a morning and an afternoon, and an evening and a Saturday.
Yeah, certainly did.
Sports. You were a sportscaster.
It was.
Do you ever do play-by-play?
No. I've done color analysis.
But that means that. So
what's
I'm going to
color analysis?
And the give. And then so Lee Haxtell Hamilton.
And Sully, I tell you what. You look at the block from the right guard there. He moved the nose guard out of the way. Linebacker came up. He got sealed. Easy touchdown.
Wow.
See? That was good.
You're good.
That was
thank
good. You.
Yeah.
Nice job.
And then end every sentence with everybody.
Yeah. Can I just say I'm trying to get down with soccer, and I really want to get down with hockey. But anytime you have a 2-0 unsurmountable lead, I'm having a problem following. Yeah. When you have to go like this, oh, close, damn.
Well, this one's over.
Like it's like 1-0.
Right.
Like, you know, it's 7-0 in the second inning. I'm going to the bar down the street of the Gas Lamp District next to Petco Park.
Yes.
If it's 1-0 in the first, we should all go, huh? Let's go down to the pub. I mean, honestly, I don't understand. It's a lesson in patience. It has to be.
It really is.
I agree.
Because it's like, damn, no.
Yeah.
And then two hours of.
Yeah. You have to get to
know
the strategy.
And they call themselves professionals.
I know.
Guys only scored one goal.
The amount of soccer players that have died on the field and then miraculously, a couple minutes later, pop up, keep on running.
They're Oscar-winning actors.
It's
better than the NBA.
Those trainers have the power of God in their hands.
Yep.
I heal you and command you to rise.
And look who is here from New York City. Howie Font is with us, the man with the...
Yeah. Look at that hair. Come on.
He just shakes his head automatically. He automatically like just suffering you.
God.
Howie, what do you got for us today on this Wednesday? I loved our Circuit City conversation.
I loved
our Circuit City conversation yesterday. That really prompted all of the places.
Oh my gosh.
That have sucked. Dr. Yep. Leventhal, Levitz.
The
Warehouse Tower Records. I mean, I could go on. All the stuff that was going to be here forever.
Yeah.
I mean,
we were just talking about Aaron Brothers.
If Sears Roebuck could go out of business, anything could go out of business.
Can you even get Tough Skins anymore?
If
anywhere?
The Cleveland no, Huskies. They're called Huskies.
Okay.
Yeah, Mr. Green Jeans.
I know it's a little more recent, a little newer, but we're going to do another one of those on MoviePass because I'm nostalgic for it. I really.
Is that the movie phone? Was that what that is?
MoviePass was a deal where you paid a monthly subscription and you got to go to the movies like 5 times a month or something.
See, that's a millennial thing. Do you remember 1-800 movie phone?
Yeah.
Where you got the time. Howard, did you ever have to go on the phone to find out what time the movie was playing?
No. There's an ancient episode of the show Seinfeld that talked about, but I've never.
Kramer.
I went back to an ancient line of television.
Howie, have you ever had to go on the phone to call and find out what time it was?
Yeah.
I just text. Calling on the phone is creepy.
What was the number? What was the number?
8-5-3-1-2-1-2.
8-5-3-1-2-1-2. That's fine. Have you ever had to do this? Oh.
Yeah, the rotary.
Do you ever have a rotary phone?
I don't think you guys have had to do that either.
Oh, yes. Yeah, absolutely we did.
Rotary.
Do you remember the yellow, the avocado green rotary phone?
Of course.
And not a Sears Slimline either.
Nope.
Okay. Slimline was a whole different story, mister.
Yeah.
This was like.
And the cord.
And there's, by the way, there was something. There was some. Okay, listen. No tactile. Satisfaction on the iPhone. But there was this. It felt good.
Oh my God!
Right? Do you remember that?
Yeah. You were earning that phone.
And then from there, I went to the Sears Slimline, which is good. Then I got the rubber buttons that moved on. And then you went to a payphone. I was like,
Yeah.
I'm gonna. You know.
And when were smoke signals?
Stand by.
Oh.
We haven't got to how we say that. We haven't got to. Welcome to MoviePod. Do you remember movie phone? Do you remember?
I do.
Why don't you just tell me the movie you want to see?
Yeah.
That was
today. Raiders and the Lost Ark, 2 p.m., 10 p.m., 5 p.m.
And if you didn't write it down fast enough, you had to wait to hear the whole thing.
Let's all go to the lobby. Let's all go to the lobby. Do you remember that?
Welcome to the Big Biz Show, featuring insight, analysis, and a lot of stuff that's none of your business.
Hold on. This is the Big Biz Show. I think it is their business.
Making the markets work for you. Here's the man with the plan, Sully.
My dad's got a can of snot.
My dad's a genius.
Throw us in here, Michael.
It is the Big Biz Show. Hope you guys are having a great day. Men and women of the United States Armed Forces, thank you for what you do, what you do for us. And we're over 170 countries. All the ships at sea on the American Forces Network. Casa, Mary Bird, Godwin, Greg, and Sully.
So the we're talking about what was it? How did this whole thing start when we started talking about obsolescence? No, that was yesterday. What did you start talking about, Howie? I forgot.
Circuit City.
No, how do we do we get to movie phone, Howie?
Oh,
movie pass.
I beg your pardon. Let me pull you back. Yep. Movie pass. He says, "Hey, you know, whatever happened to whatever happened to the iPhone? Like, Howie, you got to go back."
Yeah.
He's like, "Movie pass? What the hell? You ever heard of movie pass?"
Oh, the iPhone, ye yonder years of 2007.
Oof. Oh my God.
But which is interesting because you realize that the word iPhone wasn't in our lexicon 16 years ago.
Nope.
And the word iPad wasn't in our lexicon.
Nope. Has tablet replaced the word iPad? Like, oh, I'm on my tablet, no. Or is it still iPad?
It's still iPad.
No, they're different things. iPads are the better ones.
It's iPad tablet. Has it always been Mac PC in your mind?
Yes, 100%.
Oh, yeah.
Well, since we're, sorry, Greg.
Let's not even talk about
the
people with
the iPad. I wholeheartedly agree.
No, listen, you're a broadcaster now.
Yes. Wow, this is.
Oh, that's an 8-track tape
ain't
player.
Ain't she a beaut?
Right?
Listen, Buttercup. This is an 8-track tape player that has the Eagles' greatest hits in it from 1976.
This is how I roll.
You could hear the song Take It Easy and what's the one running down the road? Oh, that is Take It Easy.
And I watch
Sounds Groovy.
I watch
Howie, what do you got there for the market today? What's going on?
Yeah, so you were mentioning it a little bit yesterday. I wanted to follow up. The market has done really well, actually, in spite of itself. And that's my point now. It's looking a little flat the last week or so, and the data looks flat going forward because inflation is just not going down. We have the high rates. We've had high rates for a while, and we don't see the inflation print coming down. We are doing some things. The president announced yesterday that he's going to release a million barrel of oils from the reserve. That's going to lower oil prices. But when you mess with things like
that. He also finished
that,
the sentence by saying, mommy.
Examples.
he also announced he'd drop prices. They said, mommy.
He says pause.
Sorry.
No, not at all.
I made fun of Reagan the same way. And Trump.
They're all targets.
They're all
100%.
Targets.
100%.
No, they're the biggest target.
This is what's interesting about this is because at some point, we're all fish, right? It's like when you, my best analogy about the stock market is when I used to go to the Charger games and you'd be on the 15 freeway south, which is an artery north and south in San Diego, if you're from another city,
mm-hmm.
And you're going down the freeway and everybody gets in the right-hand lane because you're going to get off on Friars Road to go to the stadium at that time.
Yes, you are.
Well, you can do two things. You can either go and realize where you live in the city and realize there's two lanes and go all the way up to the front, save yourself a half hour and just go off. Or if it was just one lane, you would what I call a snake and break. Which is,
yeah.
I think we all know.
Yes.
About to do the snake and break.
Sure.
And it's stressful, but I love it.
But it is. And the interesting part is we're fish in terms of how we invest. We're fish in terms of what line we get in. We're fish in terms of what we think the status quo is going to be. And I think in the terms of this inflation, yes, this economy shut off like a light switch. It's going back on like a sunrise and a slow one at that. And at some point, just like you get investor fatigue or donor fatigue, you talked about the election, there's donor fatigue into, mm-hmm. I've already given money.
Mm-hmm.
There's investor fatigue in terms of, I'm not investing any more in that company. I'm tired of waiting. I think there was an inflation fatigue here because yes, much like the Great Correction or the Great Recession, okay, we as business owners had to fire people and do the same with less people. Guess what happened when the economy came back? And it came back with a term. We didn't hire people. We just made more money. This inflation thing is sort of the same way because we have inflation fatigue because we're used to paying the higher prices now. We've already made concessions in other parts of our lives. We don't have to go to dinner as much. We don't get coffee as much. We don't buy as many Red Bulls and Slim Jims as much.
Dang it.
And we've realized how we can live this inflation. So, you know, we may as well, look at it. Now I've kind of got this managed. Let's start investing again. And suddenly mm-hmm. we're seeing the investment. And keep in mind, Only 43% of Americans invest in the stock market. 100% of Americans participate in the economy. Mm. You see the difference there?
Yeah. Mm.
So the economy is a great indicator, but as far as the investment world goes, Howie, I think you're absolutely right about picking up on what we talked about the other day, and that is the fact that investors are fatigued of sitting on the sidelines.
For sure.
So yeah. why do you suppose, look at, you and I are not moving the needle on Apple because we invested, even if we're dollar cost averaging every day. None of us are. Institutions are. But why do you think the institutions started getting smart and ignoring the open air indicators at the Fed? Because the Fed is really the one saying, look, we still have high spending and high inflation. Until we can knock the spending down, let's raise interest rates up because people won't spend as much if their credit card interest rates are higher. I mean, that's sort of the idea there. Why do you suppose institutions are ignoring that and going back in? Because institutions are the ones moving. The institutional investors are the ones that are moving the needle on this market.
Look, half the story is definitely what we've just been talking about. Opportunity costs. We got to get invested at some point, and it's leaving money on the table. But the other half is it's probably going to be okay, but probably means 60%. Most investment banks, JP Morgan came out with a note yesterday that said 60% chance soft landing. Soft landing means, yeah, the market doesn't do great, but it doesn't do horrible. And then it starts to grow.
Or when falls on the couch. Howie, you broke up there for a second. Tell me, right before you said 60%, what did you say there for a second? Your feed broke up. Tell us the moral of the story one more time.
Sorry about that. Investment banks, JP Morgan came out with a note yesterday that said 60% chance of a soft landing.
Why so? Right before that, you're telling us, why do you suppose they did that?
Well, there's a lot of, we're in a really flat environment where for every negative thing, they're cutting in half the size of hoagie sandwiches, there's another thing that says Target's lowering prices on a few goods. So we're in a kind of neutral state and no one really knows. You know that because JP Morgan is giving you basically a coin toss on the economy. 60%.
Howard Vaughn.
Landing.
Yeah, but when Target lowers price on.
Go ahead.
No, when Target lowers a price on a few goods, are those the important goods? The goods that are really going to matter to us?
Well, what matters to you?
I love them.
Consumers? What matters to you?
Maybe household items. Maybe now they sell groceries there at Target.
What about gas and food?
Gas and food as well.
Which
absolutely.
Is not part of the CPI. Consumer price index. It's, consumer price index is just how much prices have gone up since yesterday or last month.
Right.
Excluding, stripping out food and gas because they're so volatile.
Going back to the Target, though, app, I'm on my Target app daily and I'm ordering because you can drive up and
wait.
I care.
Oh, because you go park in?
Yes, and it's not, I just park and they bring it to my car and I order it.
Pretty soon you're not going to have any bones. You know why? Pretty soon we're just all going to float.
I know.
We don't have any bones, no muscle. We're just going to float because we just drive. We don't get out of the car.
But just circus freaks.
First of all, is there anything more satisfying than pushing a Target cart? You follow what I'm saying?
Oh, especially down the.
First of all, the handle is this thick. It's like.
Ergonomically correct. It's a very nice cart.
It is a nice cart.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, and my kids just got the cool cart. They had the double cart.
Right.
For the two kids.
Yep.
Yeah, you had to be able to, get
back
that rig up and get that, move that. But the thing is, they're just like sturdy. You could live under one if you had to.
And they have the cup holders you can attach to the side and put your Starbucks
exactly
in.
Right. Or a Starbucks cup with your choice of beverage. But I have no idea how we got there. So tell me,
I care when I see the little red line saying that there's a sale happening on a product that I purchased.
When did this happen?
I do.
When did this happen? Is it always
so they just rebranded. Their red card is now the circle card now, or maybe it's vice versa. I can't remember now exactly, but they rebranded. The Target lady from Saturday Night Live is now their
And how much are you saving on these red lines?
I don't even know how much it is. I just love to. It's pennies, probably.
Is this the same woman that doesn't want to do this anymore?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
So you have to go to a blowout for how much money?
I don't do those. I don't do those, okay?
I thought you taught us
weeks
about
ago
the blowout.
You told us about the blowout.
I know they exist, but I take my daughters on the day of her prom. I don't go regularly.
Oh, I thought you were, okay.
Right. No.
Ew.
So are you a coupon clipper?
No, but in my Target app.
Are you a Yankee clipper? That is a ship. It's a ship.
I'm like, I don't think I am. I need to pull up this app. You guys, it's exciting when they show you things on sale.
Right, right.
This is where I'm a clipper.
Was this exciting when you were 20?
Yes, I'll tell you what was exciting. When I was at Borders Books and they said, buy four, get one free, I went in for one book, but I would buy four just to get that fifth one for free.
Damn.
We're making money, honey. Yeah. We're making, I bought four pairs of Gucci shoes today.
Yeah.
And
we
made $2,000.
It's real math. It's real.
We made $2,000. Listen,
it's fully real.
I'll let you say that because your razors cost 30% more than our razors do. Did you know this? That women's deodorant, women's razors, women's goods that we have the same of.
Yes.
Bic Blue Razor, Pink Razor. Cost 30.
Their beards are so
much
heavier.
Know this?
Yes, they are.
Oh, great. Now this is your next thing.
And now my girls buy the Flamingo.
Yeah,
well, the special thing. And now yeah, they're three times as much.
No, listen, go look. Look at the same. We have the same products in some categories.
See, that stuff I don't notice, but I like my red Target.
Can we talk tomorrow or later today about shadow inflation?
Yes.
Remember when the toilet paper roll was this big? Not anymore.
Yeah.
Remember when there was this
Hello
many
summer
chips?
Sale.
Now there's this many chips?
Inflation.
Oh, here we go.
Hello, summer sale.
Summer sale.
When am I going to get it?
Loft 100 Studios, The Big Biz Show, and our affiliates and our hosts are not registered investment advisors or broker-dealers.
Our show hosts make no commitment that the purchase of securities of companies profiled or otherwise mentioned in our programming
are suitable or advisable for any person, or that an investment in such securities will be profitable in general.
Given the nature of the company's profile and the lack of an active trading market for the securities, investing is highly speculative and carries a certain high degree of risk.
We profile selected publicly traded and privately held companies on our program.
Most of these companies that we profile have provided compensation to Loft 100 Studios and its hosts for the profile coverage.
From time to time, we sell shares of the companies profiled in the open market that we receive as compensation for coverage of client companies.
But never sell stocks if we are speaking about interviewing or covering a public company who has paid compensation.
Specific questions on compensation can be obtained by contacting producer@salientgroup.com.
Listeners should verify all claims and do their own due diligence before investing in any securities mentioned on this program.
Investing in securities is speculative and carries a high degree of risk.
We encourage our investors to invest carefully and read the investor information available at the websites on the
Securities and Exchange Commission at sec.gov and or the Financial Industry Regulatory Authority, FINRA, at www.finra.org.
I like it.
Wherever you're watching, wherever you're listening, you're probably doing both, maybe one or the other. Thanks for being along for the ride here on The Big Biz Show. For the Loft 100 Studios, Mike Costa, Mary Bird Godwin, Greg Todorov, and Sully.
Let's talk about doing a belt loop reading on Mike Costa. I'm losing belt loops now. I like it when you can see the little line and they're on this side, not on this side.
Ah,
you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah,
I like when you start getting away from the loop, the belt holes you put
and
in.
Do you realize for me,
you put your own belt loops in? Sometimes.
Really?
Yeah, when you need
to. Do you have a special tool for that? How do you do it? Because that's not easy. It's not easy.
I have an old auger that I just go.
So he's done it so many times, he has an auger.
Auger. Of course.
Can I ask you?
You may ask me anything.
How many pounds per belt loop do you think you're? Like, if I lose 5, I get a belt loop. Honestly, it's a 5-pound deal. Like, if I go, oh man, I got 10 pounds to go.
Right?
It's literally.
That's a pretty good metric.
It is scientific.
Yeah.
For me, it is. Yeah. It's like fine Swiss watches.
Yep.
How accurate that is.
Yep.
Wow.
It's like German automotive precision.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
How belt loops equal 5 pounds.
Yep.
Wow. Okay. And you know, if you have 4 belt loops, maybe I pull back on the. On the Funyuns, the Fire Cheetos, and the Red Bull, and
so
the
good, so good, so good.
It is. But you know what? And you need to have jaw muscle. You know those guys are all everything's about the jaw thing now. He's just eating Slim Jims.
Yeah,
he's a little tough, huh? Snap into his.
There's actually that one thing that the guy invented. It's like a jaw.
But you don't do that because you have a Slim Jim.
Exactly.
Steve Glover is here. Steve Glover, of course, chairman and CEO of Zyversa Therapeutics, a good friend, a good guest, and a great CEO of a company that's publicly traded on the NASDAQ under ZVSA. The reason we're talking about this is because it all comes down to weight loss.
Yes.
And I want to talk about the weight loss industry, Steve, because you guys are now restoring health, transforming lives, and now you're walking into the obesity space, which is a gold mine. I hate to talk about the grotesque part of this, but it is a gold mine, and it continues to be. Good to see you, man. How are you?
Good. How are you doing? And you guys were so helpful there.
I've been thinking about the next inclusion criteria of my clinical trial, and it's a reduction in the number of belt loops needed. I now got it.
You're going to be in the JAMA, and when you go to ASCO this year, it's going to you're going to take the top spot in speaking. Talk about what you, because obviously you guys are in the business of renal and anti-inflammatory diseases, so on and so forth. But there is a finger of narrative here regarding obesity here. I want you to talk about that.
Sure. So you talk about a hot area. You can't go, as you guys know, and look at TV or a magazine or listen to a spot with someone talking about GLP-1 and reduction of weight. And, you know, it's just a huge, huge area of focus in the industry right now. There's a lot going on. Everybody's looking at new assets and new technologies to try to look at, you know, what's next in the obesity area. And that's kind of, you know, when you look at it, it's a $150 billion market worldwide. So there's a lot of focus on the markets, trying to understand the new technologies, and not only just the new technologies, the new targets like ones that we have.
So and talk about the targets that you have, and talk about what you're going for, because it is pretty revolutionary in the world of the semaglutides and the Saxendas and the Wegovys. You guys are entering into this space, but you're entering into the space with a novel approach.
Yeah, so one of the things, you know, I'll digress for just a little bit here, for a little bit of science, but what's going on when you're overeating, you're getting a nutrient overload, right? And when that happens, obviously you continue to add pounds and you continue to increase your food intake, and this becomes a really horrible cycle for people. But what's happening also is not just the added weight, it's the complications from that weight. It's the issue of type 2 diabetes, it's the issue of cardiovascular disease. And what's happening is that your cells in your body, actually you're growing more and more fat cells. And when that happens, you begin to produce cytokines driven by inflammasomes. And those inflammasomes create more and more cytokine in your body. It's a cycle of cells dying, of fat intake increasing. And we're really focused on taking an approach inhibiting those inflammasomes. And we're doing it by using a monoclonal antibody, targeting those inflammasomes, reducing the systemic inflammation, which is causing not only obesity, but cardiovascular disease and type 2 diabetes. So we're really excited about the next 6 months here of getting some initial data back on our approach here.
Steve, my mom just told me it was a glandular problem when I was little. I guess she was being nice, but
he also said that you were belonging to a big boned tribe.
Big bone. That's what it was. But are some people just predisposed that some people are going to have an issue with it in their lives, and there's other people that can, like our executive producer Greg Todorov, eat and not gain a pound
with a bad attitude?
There is definitely, yeah, there's definitely some genetic component to it, but as humans, we love to add on to it. So I think there's no doubt there's some people are predisposed, just as people are predisposed to other diseases. I think what you're finding out here is that in our diets, you know, our biology is not really set up to deal with some of the foods that we eat. And we can add to that by taking on diet trends that we do, and that just adds to it. So, you know, if you're already predisposed and your diet is not such, you're not doing the healthy things that you need to do, you can add to your own complexity, so to speak.
His name is Steve Glover. He is the chairman and CEO of Zyversa Therapeutics, stock symbol ZVSA. You can go to investors.zyversa.com. Steve, thanks so much. I can't wait for you to get to San Diego, pal. Although, I'm not sure how healthy it would be, knowing that he has the same sense of humor as we do, and he is working on a weight loss drug, so maybe we'll just... Would you take a weight loss drug if you were a taco shy at 300 pounds? Like, yes. One more taco, you were there, would
I'm
you take one?
I'm about to take one now.
You want?
I'm ready to...
You're the skinny.
I mean, I'm not going to, but I think... I'm like,
yeah, this is that, wait, do does that. This bother you when James says, oh my God, I'm so fat?
Exactly.
Seriously, what about all the real fat
people? I just think
about... What about the real fat people? When, oh my God, I'm so fat. Greg, just zip it.
Yeah.
It's just the weight loss at this point. I've always liked to do it with
eating,
right?
You're 14 feet tall.
And
you're this thin.
Right.
I'm not, but
Do you think you need to take a weight loss right now?
Well, I just don't have the time to dedicate to an hour of working out every day.
So I just want
to
lay down.
No, I want to drive through Target and my gosh.
All right.
I want to take a not really, you know, but I'm thinking about it.
For a woman who is 6'5", you are
6'6", when she blow dries.
Thank you.
Loft 100 Studios, The Big Biz Show, and our affiliates and our hosts are not registered investment advisors or broker dealers.
Our show hosts make no commitment that the purchase of securities of companies profiled or otherwise mentioned in our programming
are suitable or advisable for any person, or that an investment in such securities will be profitable in general.
Given the nature of the company's profile and the lack of an active trading market for the securities, investing is highly speculative and carries a certain high degree of risk.
We profile selected publicly traded and privately held companies on our program.
Most of these companies that we profile have provided compensation to Loft 100 Studios and its hosts for the profile coverage.
From time to time, we sell shares of the companies profiled in the open market that we receive as compensation for coverage of client companies.
But never sell stocks. If we are speaking about interviewing or covering a public company who has paid compensation.
Specific questions on compensation can be obtained by contacting producer@sellientgroup.com.
Listeners should verify all claims and do their own due diligence before investing in any securities mentioned on this program.
Investing in securities is speculative and carries a high degree of risk.
We encourage our investors to invest carefully and read the investor information available at the websites on the
Securities and Exchange Commission at sec.gov and or the Financial Industry Regulatory Authority, FINRA, at www.finra.org.
Another beautiful day here in sunny Southern California.
You better believe it, baby.
Oh, yeah. Some of the Loft 100 Studios, The Big Biz Show rolling on. I am Mike Costa. She is Mary Bird Godwin. That handsome devil right there at the end is our executive producer, Greg Todorov.
I thought you were going to say, I'm my own grandpa, which would explain the family stick.
I'm getting there.
I'd like to introduce my sister / fiance.
Their family tree was a wreath.
Look at the day trader trio.
Oh, the best.
They make me smile.
Wow.
Whoa.
Someone's been practicing. Someone gets a paycheck this week.
Hey now.
I love these guys so much.
That's good. I met a person the other day named Ruth.
Boy, you don't hear a lot of Ruths.
Do you have palsy? Do you have
Do you have a lot of age spots?
No, yeah, so it's like exactly.
Yeah.
What's some of the old diseases and are you wearing a bustle? Like your name's like,
right.
Ruth.
Ruth Gordon.
Do you have the vapors?
Yeah, exactly.
Vapors.
No kidding. Why do I work, Barnes? I got a Hollywood. Gonna make it big here in Hollywood. Yeah, Ruth.
Was she wearing bloomers?
I was like, Ruth? What's your middle name? Opal? I had a grandma Opal.
Does she have a hat on with a shawl?
Yeah, no, but she, you know, was.
A veil.
Excuse me.
But she was carrying a purse and, you know, with a little.
Right there?
Oh. Ruth.
The stockings.
Like 1935 call. They want their fried green tomatoes back.
She
I'm not kidding.
Stockings to her knees, right?
I don't know. I don't want to look.
And those very comfortable.
In the days of the croup and palsy.
Black lung.
Like thinking, yeah. And what you call the vapors.
Black lung pop.
Yeah, exactly.
Black lung pop.
At the black lung pop.
I know. Do you?
Her best friend's Mavis.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Earl.
And Ethel.
Ethel would come over for bridge.
Ethel reminds me of the gas. Or the paint remover, methyl ethyl ketone, MEK.
That's right.
But Ethel, would you like regular or Ethel? Well, I like Ethel. I'd like to jump for joy.
Ambrosia salad?
Ambrosia. What's ambrosia salad? What is that, Michael?
Oh, it's gross.
Is it jello
it's
salad?
Like fruit
well,
and
it's fruit and marshmallows mayonnaise. And coconut.
It's bad. There's a white sauce.
Yeah. Don't say that.
They're always, Mary.
Oh, God.
He was on the way to the store to make some aspic. Is it aspic? Is aspic the
aspic is tomato jello.
I thought it was.
What? Oh, what? That's not
and tomato jello is my gang name. Yeah. Yeah. So here we go. Corey Perlman is a social media keynote speaker. I will tell you, as someone who does several keynote speeches a year, want a big shout out to all of our speakers bureaus that help us get the gigs. He is the founder and CEO of a company called Impact Social Media. And you'll know why we lost half of our followers just because of that last segment. He's here to help us talk about automatically, authentically prioritizing your platforms and getting out there on the DSPs, babe.
Yeah.
And figuring out. Corey, how are you, sir? Thanks for stopping by.
I'm great. Thanks for having me. I was really enjoying that segment, by the way.
Yeah, you're such a liar. You're off. Bye. Yeah, let's talk some more about tomato jello, Corey.
That was my nickname, too. That's
yeah,
crazy.
You know, nothing makes it. Nothing, you know, did you have to say tomato jello?
It's a disgusting concept, I realize.
This segment brought to you by Lume
tomato,
deodorant.
Tomato jelly. Corey, is social media going to be our downfall?
Or is it already?
Yeah. Well, it probably is already. It certainly is a frustrating place for many of us, but it's also the new way people do business. So I think if you can't beat them, join them.
Right, because I'm sorry, Mary, but it's the negativity, and it's the keyboard warriors, and it's the snark, and the sniping, and the just belittling. Is there still a huge percentage of people that are using it in a positive way versus the negative people?
Yeah, you know, I once had a gentleman in my audience say, you know, Corey, I don't want social media. I don't want another place for people to attack me.
That was Mike when he had a wooden leg back in fifth grade. He wanted to play with the other children, ignoring the jeers of the fifth graders at Curie Elementary School.
Exactly. It's like another playground. Yeah. You get beat up in that.
He also founded Captain Morgan, took a big exit, and he's been retired since he was in 12th grade. But it's true, though. It's a fair question. I'll let you go ahead and answer it.
Yeah, and I said to him, you know, that's the exact reason why you want to be on social media. At least it's your playground, if you will. You get to mostly control the rules. And they got to play by your rules. And so if somebody comes on there and says something stupid, you have my favorite key on the keyboard, which is delete.
See, but Corey, awesome. What do you say to guys like me where you say at least it's the playground? At most it's the playground to me. I think that at first, and by the way, only someone who graduates from Harvard creates a social media app so they can talk to the person living next door to them in their dorm room. So my point is, you know, just like Napster served its purpose in its place in terms of downloading digital music, which turned into what is now Spotify, Apple Music, and everything else, social media, take MySpace onto Facebook or whatever, take Vine into Reels, right? Yeah. Hasn't social media, other than, pardon me, Instagram, and Instacart for me personally. I have several friends on Instacart. They most of them deliver stuff to my house, mostly tequila. Yep. But don't you think that we're coming down to where we can homogenize this down to a platform that we all want to use that is, like I can tell you, anybody using Facebook also is named Ruth and Opal. We're talking about,
yes.
Right?
Over 40.
Right. Anybody using...
Yeah, they just sent me a friend request. Yes.
Right. I mean, and the funny part is I'm down to the point now where I'm not even looking at social anymore, except for if I want to go and look at something, I go to YouTube, which tends to have the reels on social.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I know we've got 100,000 followers on Sully Speaks Money, and I don't even do it anymore.
Right.
Aren't we going to homogenize down to one sort of best practices central thing until the next thing comes up?
I don't think it's one necessarily, but I do think it's a few. I think those that try to be on all things to all people, at minimum, do it mediocre, and most of the time they embarrass themselves. That'd be like me trying to be on TikTok. It just doesn't work.
Right.
But I like about two platforms.
That's what I said. Then I got 3 million views on something. Listen, these knucklehead PAs here and Mary talked me into it. It's like, and I said, it's like, okay, you catch me saying something on TV, you can post it. But I understand what you're saying there. Speaking of TikTok, I don't mean to interrupt you there.
That's okay.
Is TikTok still the flavor of the month, in your opinion?
It's definitely the flavor of the month, but a business person has to ask themselves, is that my audience? They still are very, very young, 13 to 26. Yeah. And as you mentioned, Instagram's an older generation, and so is LinkedIn. So the question is, who's your market? Who's your customer?
Right. Who's going to buy your product? Because you can be on there creating great content that's funny, but these kids aren't going to buy your product, most likely.
That's right.
Unless it's makeup. unless you're in the makeup or wardrobe fashion industry, that's where they're selling a lot of product, right?
Another thing, so let me talk about this, and I'm going to use it in terms of podcasting. And Mike and I will tell you, as on-air broadcasters and radio for 30 years and then got into TV, podcasting in the beginning was for broadcasters who couldn't make it. I'm going to do a show. Mm-hmm. I got a show.
I have a microphone.
I got a show. Listen, having a microphone in front of you no more makes you a broadcaster than me having a fast car makes me a Formula One driver. Yep. Now, that's not to say that people like Adam Carolla, Conan O'Brien, Joe Rogan, who's the guy who wrote Tools for Titans, Tim Ferriss, all fantastic. And there's lots of great content out there. The issue that I have with this whole thing is that people are in this game to be famous, not to necessarily impart wisdom. And I swear if they took 5 minutes and understood what you do say and what you don't say to hold an audience, I think that it would be more credible to an audience and I'd get more out of it. We're out of time, Corey, but you guess what? You're coming back with us for a full hour.
Yeah.
You need to come to San Diego tomorrow. I'll see you then. Thanks, pal. His name is Corey Perlman. Impact Social Media, CoreyPerlman.com. Seriously, I want you back. I want you on a regular basis. Corey
Perlman. I didn't even get to ask my question.
Yeah, that's because he told me not to make sure you didn't ask. You know that Betty, the thing she knows about social media? I know about advertising. Name the movie. Hey, Rock, I know about advertising.
I'm going to go with Rocky.
And he said Rocky.
Then when I said, hey, Rock.
He literally said,
hey, Rock.
I didn't hear Rock.
It is the large financial program, also known as the Big Biz Show. Kind of screws you up there. You're like, wait a second. What's going on my watch?
That's like when I used to do my stock picks on Sunday.
Yeah.
I did my stock picks on Sunday, and we'd look at, you know, how I did. Russ would do his 5 minutes later on Monday. Incidentally, they were very close to my stock pick.
Costa River Godwin, Greg Todorov, and
70%
Sully.
Increase. That's what we do. We need to do Pick My Shorts.
Yes.
Thank you. Great show today. Great Wednesday show. Thanks again. Thanks again to Steve Glover. Thanks again to, what was our social media guy's name? That guy was fantastic.
Corey.
Corey Perlman.
Yep. Yeah, it's good. As we finish the program, let's finish on a low note. Pat, it's not because of Patrick DeHaan. Patrick's been with me for, we've interviewed him for, I'm going to say, Patrick, it's got to be like 15 years you've been on this show. He, of course, is the head of petroleum analysis for GasBuddy. GasBuddy.com. You ever see that gas, the national map with a gas price temperature map on it?
Regularly.
What were the old colors? We were used to be red. Now we're purple. Remember, you guys changed the colors on me, Patrick. It used to be red and green,
yeah.
Right? Now we're purple.
Yeah, you're right. We made it more accessible. I found that too the hard way. And by the way, I like how we saved the worst news for the end right at the low point here.
By the way,
news this time.
You look fantastic. Are you getting in shape because you just can't eat because of gas prices? Or are you actively
walking every day?
You're a shadow of your former self.
That's the beauty of high gas prices, right? Is you can get a hop on the bike or walk. So high gas prices are physically great for me.
That's exactly right. So talk to us. Behind your left shoulder there, we're seeing a country that is purple and orange, but yet over on the West Coast, we continue to be yellow. I'm assuming that because we have so many environmental add-ons to our price per gallon as well as taxes, is that the main reason that we usually have the most expensive gas?
Well, let me get out the rule book for California gasoline. I'll turn to chapter 34. On that page, we're going to find that, yes, gasoline taxes, you have cap and trade, you have a low carbon fuel standard, you have the highest taxes in the nation, you have your own blend of gasoline.
Oh yeah, don't forget, we go into the summer blend here. What is the summer blend, by the way? Is that just a scam?
You know, it's not a scam. It is something implemented after the Clean Air Act amendments in the 70s. The problem between summer and winter gasoline, and by the way, California is a bit of this problem on steroids, because in California, the Air Resources Board holds jurisdiction over this. But essentially the big difference here is that winter gasoline has more butane. That starts your car in colder weather easier. Butane, the stuff in lighters, it's real cheap. It's like 50 to 60 cents a gallon. The problem with that is it doesn't cooperate with the air. It evaporates really easily. And in the warmer months, that contributes to ozone. And so summer gasoline has less cheap butane and more alkylate, which is kind of the opposite, not 60 or 70 cents a gallon, but about $5 a gallon. And that's where the cost differential comes from.
Patrick, one of the happiest days of my life occurred about a month ago. I sold our diesel motor car.
Diesel was actually...
It was supposed to be, but now, Patrick, assuage my fears. I know Greg Todorov, our executive producer, has a diesel.
Well, to your point, a lot of what happens in California now is biodiesel. So, that's, again, a California regulation is that a certain amount of diesel in California now has to be biodiesel. And actually, this is interesting how this affects gasoline is some refineries in California have gotten incentivized to make the transition from traditional refinery to producing biodiesel. And a lot of what goes into that is then soybean oil. So, yeah, there's a huge cost increase associated with making that jump over to biodiesel.
Are you concerned? I don't know if concern is the right word, but we hear about EVs, which is, again, my term for electric vehicles. I would like to know, is EV going to affect the gas price? Because obviously there is a supply-demand issue. If we had the infrastructure to go EV across the country, which we currently don't, but I think we will at some point, will that have an impact from the sheer economic standpoint of Econ 101? Less people are demanding gas, therefore... There's fewer dollars chasing more product, which would drive something down in an economic equation. How do you feel about that in the future?
Well, what you're seeing is a lot of growing pains. We're going to see a lot more of those growing pains. You look at the grid, you look at energy consumption, it's already through the roof. The nation badly needs more power plants. Talk about nuclear power, that plant in Georgia that was tens of billions of dollars over budget. We need a lot more of that to have these EV dreams fulfilled. The problem, though, is to your point, though, will it eventually reduce gas prices? Well, oil companies, and this is where politics can get involved, the Biden administration has really taken a very frontline stance on the oil sector, trying to make it more difficult. That's not really the point here. The point is that the oil industry is seeing that the writing is on the wall and that administration is going to push Americans to EVs. So at that point, why spend money maintaining existing infrastructure if the administration is basically saying, well, your time is, we're counting down. So the question is, will EVs be pushed? Yeah. Will oil companies stop investing in their refineries? That's the key. It could be a very bumpy ride.
Patrick DeHaan for president. Thank you, buddy. I appreciate your time as usual. See you next week if we can get to. You know, one thing that people don't realize is that just because the price of oil goes up or down doesn't mean the price of gas goes up or goes down. It's like, think of oil like potatoes and McDonald's French fries, okay? The price of potato goes up or down. Prices are pretty static on French fries, regardless of what they're paying for potatoes. What drives the cost up or down on French fries is competition. Burger King is now charging less for their French fries. We're gonna drop our French fries down. Mm-hmm. Same thing in the oil and gas business. For oil, just because oil gets more expensive doesn't mean the gas has to get more expensive. Okay, there really is some economy to this. I'm wondering what's going to happen when the EV thing, which I don't think it's going anywhere, as long as there's an infrastructure. The problem is, once again, the analogy of Mike Costa after a large bran muffin and a cup of Joe in the morning on the Golden Gate Bridge, wall-to-wall traffic with all EVs. Do we have, because he's heavier at that point, let's face it, and then the car is also 2 tons apiece.
Yeah, yeah.
That's a real issue we have to deal with. I mean, one of the main arteries from California to Arizona, which is the 8 freeway, had a bridge collapse about 4 years ago. The main artery to get to Arizona was over for 4 days.
Yeah.
That means commerce. That means goods and services. That means everything else. Well, and that's just from wear and tear. That's just from, bad fiscal planning on both states' part. But I wonder what's going to happen in my mind when there is such a crush of, no pun intended, of EVs that we have to suddenly catch up sooner than later. I think gas prices are going to drop.
But aren't
let me talk on a plus size model.
Aren't the major domestic manufacturers of automobiles just taking a bath on their EV fleets?
For right now, because there's no infrastructure.
Yeah.
Right? How confident do you feel when you drive your EV that you can?
Not very. You have to plan it.
So, right, okay.
If you want to do a road trip.
Cool tool.
Yeah, if you want to do a road trip, you absolutely have to plan it. Here's where I have to stop and do one of the, because they have the superchargers.
Yeah.
Takes 15 minutes, you plug it
well,
in,
you, get
you go,
older, when
you
get
run into the grocery store real quick and then come back out and the thing's ready to go.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I'm a proponent in some ways, but in a lot of ways, we're not there yet.
How much more are they? I don't even know.
30% more.
Really? But then you get a tax break on?
ahead. Thank you.
You get a tax break on a friggin' SUV that's heavy. Come on now.
Hey.
That's never been trusted. That does it for us. We'll see you tomorrow. Have a great Wednesday night.